start off with a scripture reading from Galatians chapter 4, verses 1 through 7. If you're using the Bible in the pews, it is page 861. Galatians chapter 4, verses 1 through 7. Bible in the pews, page 861. Galatians chapter 4, starting in verse 1. Now I say that the heir, as long as he is a child, differeth nothing from a servant, though he be Lord of all, but is under tutors and governors until the time appointed of the Father. Even so we, when we were children, were in bondage under the elements of the world. But when the fullness of time was come, God sent forth his Son, made of a woman, made under the law, to redeem them that are under the law, that we might receive the adoption of sons. And because ye are sons, God hath sent forth the Spirit of his Son into your hearts, crying, Abba, Father. Wherefore thou art no more a servant, but a son. And if a son, then an heir of God through Christ. 426 in your hymnals this morning. Dwelling in Beulah Land. 426 in your hymnals. I do see some higher notes, so for your guys' sake, I'm going to have you guys stand as you sing, so that way it's easier to hit some of those notes.
Supply, for I am dwelling in. be seated.
We will sing 61 in your hymnals. Jesus is the sweetest name I know. I'm so sorry. But never has there been a name so dear. Tis this heart of mine, as the name divine, the precious, precious name of Jesus. Jesus is the sweetest name I know, and he's just the same. His lovely name, and that's the reason why I love him so. Oh, Jesus is the sweetest name I know. There is no name on earth or heaven above that we should give such honor and such blessed name. Let us all acclaim that wondrous, glorious name of Jesus. Jesus is the sweetest name I know, and he's just the same as his lovely name, and that's the reason why. Someday I shall see him face to face, to thank and praise him for his wondrous grace, which he gave to me when he made me free, the blessed Son of God called Jesus. Jesus is the sweetest I know, and he's just the same as his lovely name, and that's the reason why I love him so. Oh, Jesus is the sweetest name I know. Thank you for your singing. Amanda has special music for us today. The lyrics for the special music is on the back of your insert. So if you would like to know what the lyrics are to the song as she's playing it, feel free to read along through that. Thank you very much, Amanda.
Amen. In Christ alone. Well, this is Father's Day. I actually remember. And so I have a Father's Day message and will not be in Luke this morning. There are two main passages that we'll be dealing with.
I turned it on now, okay. Romans chapter 8, verses 9 through 16, and what was read for you this morning, Galatians 4, 1 through 7. And we'll begin in by reading Romans 8, 9 through 17. And when you get that passage, if you're able, would you please stand as we honor God and His Word as it's read together. Romans chapter 8, verses 9 through 16. But ye are not in the flesh, but in the Spirit, if so be that the Spirit of God dwell in you. Now, if any man have not the Spirit of God, he is none of his. And if Christ be in you, the body is dead because of sin, but the Spirit is life because of righteousness. But if the Spirit of him that raised up Jesus from the dead dwell in you, he that raised up Christ from the dead shall also quicken your mortal bodies by his Spirit that dwelleth in you. Therefore, brethren, we are debtors, not to the flesh, to live after the flesh. For if ye live after the flesh, ye shall die. But if ye through the Spirit do mortify the deeds of the body, ye shall live. For as many as are led by the Spirit of God, they are the sons of God. For ye have not received the spirit of bondage again to fear, but ye have received the spirit of adoption, whereby we cry, Abba, Father. The Spirit itself beareth witness with our spirit that we are the children of God. Father, thank you for your word and the truth that you have revealed to us from your word, that it's not just words on a page. It's your message to us. And it's a special, precious message. May we see it as such. May we understand it. May we grasp how it applies to us individually and as a whole. I pray it in Jesus' name. Amen. Thank you for standing. You may be seated. Children cry out to their fathers with confidence and boldness because, after all, he's their father. Unless you have some kind of father that's not a good father. But generally speaking, kids will cry out to their fathers because of just the fact that he's special. They have that relationship with him as father. You should make sure you can cry out to God as your father. And there's some ways to make sure that you can as we look at these passages this morning. As you saw there in Romans 8 and 9 through 16 and Galatians 4, these passages, there are some things that are similar, and the first thing that you can see regarding being able to cry out to God as your Father is that you must receive the Holy Spirit of God through salvation. And we see this primarily in Romans chapter 8 in this passage before us. As you look at verse 12 and 13 again, it says, therefore, brethren, we are debtors not to the flesh to live after the flesh, for if ye live after the flesh, ye shall die. But if ye through the Spirit do mortify the deeds of the body, ye shall live. For as many as are led by the Spirit of God, they are the sons of God. He said, if you don't have the Spirit of God dwelling in you, then you don't have God. Now, how do you get the Spirit of God? It's clear in here also that you have to have Jesus in verse 11. But if the Spirit of him that raised up Jesus from the dead dwell in you, he that raised up Christ from the dead shall also quicken your mortal bodies. In verse 10, and if Christ be in you, the body is dead because of sin, but the Spirit is life because of righteousness. When a person receives the Lord Jesus Christ as their Savior, they automatically and immediately also receive the Holy Spirit of God. The Holy Spirit comes and dwells within that believer the moment of salvation. If the Holy Spirit of God is not dwelling in a person, they have not received Jesus Christ as Savior. They have not been saved from their sin. The only way to have the Holy Spirit is to receive Jesus Christ as Savior, and then you receive the Holy Spirit. You should see from these verses, you will, as a believer, if you have trusted in Christ, you will submit to the Holy Spirit's control if you are truly saved. He talked about the Holy Spirit's leading and not living after the flesh. You will live according to the Spirit if you are submitting to the Spirit of God. And it's only the sons of God that will submit to the Holy Spirit of God. Now, this kind of submission is the thought of a willing submission. And not willing because I'm forced to do it, so I will to do it, but a voluntary, loving, willing submission. Years ago now, and it's been years ago, I was in high school. And in my high school, back in the time when dirt was just getting started, some say I'm as old as dirt. Well, as dirt was just getting started back in those days, we had a way of going through driver's education that's different than what they do nowadays. But I remember that I was in driver's education class so that I could eventually get my driver's license. Now I know they still have driver's ed classes, but they were a little different back then. And we had several student drivers that would get in the car, and the instructor would get in the car and sit next to us. And the instructor was the one who was in charge, or he was supposed to be in charge anyway. He had some emergency pedals and things just in case. And unfortunately, we had one fellow in my class that he had to use that a few times. But what the instructor would do is he would tell you what you were supposed to do, and it was your responsibility to submit willingly. Turn left up here. Hit the turn signal before you turn. Check both ways before you turn, and stop at this light up here, and make sure you stop ahead of time so that you're not jamming on the brakes. And on it would go. And then we eventually got to a point where we had this little course, and there were several cars. And he sat up in this little tower, and we turned the radio on, and he could tell each driver, we were individually in these cars, each driver what he wanted us to do, and we had to go through this course, and there were stops and turns and this and that and the other, yields, and his job was to tell us what to do, and our job was to submit. The Holy Spirit is leading a believer and will lead a believer, and the believer's job is to willingly do what the Holy Spirit tells us to do. Now, you can only do that as you sense the Holy Spirit leading. And you will sense that the Holy Spirit is leading if you're truly saved. Now we have to be a little cautious here as we talk about this, because there is a thought in many people's minds that this is a totally subjective kind of thing, that the Holy Spirit leads us just through our feelings and senses, you know, on our own. And how many times I've heard a Christian say, well, I felt the Holy Spirit leading this way. Well, how did you feel the Holy Spirit leading you that way? Did you eat pizza? You know, ice cream can make you feel a lot different than pizza. So did the Holy Spirit lead you differently? Based upon feelings, we need to be cautious. Now, there is some subjective truth that the Holy Spirit can impress upon our hearts and minds, a direction that He is leading. But the Holy Spirit's leading is generally very objective. And the Holy Spirit leads by the Word of God. The Holy Spirit will take the Word of God and lead us in the direction that God wants us to go. So primarily, we need to be spending time in the Word of God, and the Holy Spirit of God will take the things of God and show us and direct us in our lives. Now, He only does that to the sons of God. A son can look up to God the Father and call Him Father, but if you're not a son, you cannot cry out, Abba, Father. Now, Abba is a Chaldee form of the same word, Father, a reverential respect to God as Father, repeated twice. You know, even Jesus on the cross said, my God, twice. Why hast thou forsaken me? And you find in the scriptures that that's repeated twice. It gives emphasis, and it shows that intimacy. Now, sometimes a child will come up to their dad and repeat too. Say, Daddy, Daddy! Have you ever had that happen to you, fathers? You know, it gets your attention, doesn't it? And that means they mean business. And for whatever reason, they're crying out, Daddy, either excitement or need or want. That gets the attention. So as we look at this portion, you must receive the Holy Spirit of God through salvation. I would encourage you that if you have not already received the Lord Jesus as Savior, that you do that today in order that you can be saved from your sin, and then you will also receive the Holy Spirit of God. And as a believer, stay in the Word of God and prayer to receive the Holy Spirit's instructions and to sense His leading. Make the objective leading your priority over any subjective leading of the Holy Spirit through your feelings. Now, we are told in the Scripture that we are to test the spirits to see if they are from God. How do you test the spirit? Again, you go back to the Word of God. But if you have a feeling that the Spirit is leading, test to see if that Spirit is from God. Years ago, as I was at Faith Baptist Bible College, there was a black man who was in college, and he was talking to me how that when he got saved years prior, he was in the military, that he had a pastor that was teaching them how to sing properly. And he says, you know, I believed, and he says, we black people have to move when we sing, you know. And he says, I was instructed and I was encouraged to understand that that was the Spirit moving, but it wasn't the Holy Spirit. Not that saying that you can't move when you sing, but the kind of movement he was talking about, he said, I came to understand that wasn't the Holy Spirit moving in that kind of movement. Test the spirits to see if they're actually from God. And you do that by the Word of God. Embed God's Word into your heart so that the Holy Spirit can lead you in circumstances where you do not have the Word of God available at hand, or you can't pull it out. So you have the Word of God in your heart, and the Holy Spirit can impress that upon your mind and bring that to your attention for your direction and for your encouragement at any moment. The more that you have the Word of God in you, the more the Holy Spirit can use that in a moment's notice. So I would encourage you to embed the Word of God in your heart. You can do that through memory, but continue in the Word of God constantly so it becomes a natural part of your life. When you have the Holy Spirit of God, He'll lead you to the point where you can cry out in confidence, Abba, Father, to our Heavenly Father. Secondly, relate as an adopted son to God. We see it started here in Romans chapter 8, but then we see it more again in Galatians chapter 4. Notice in verses 15 and 16 of Romans chapter 8, for ye have not received the spirit of bondage again to fear, but ye have received the spirit of adoption, whereby we cry, Abba, Father, Father, Father. The Spirit itself, or Himself, beareth witness with our spirit that we are the children of God. Now, go with me to Galatians chapter 4, and we'll look at Galatians chapter 4, verses 4 through 7 specifically here. But when the fullness of time was come, God sent forth His Son, made of a woman, made under the law, to redeem them that were under the law, that we might receive the adoption of sons. And because ye are sons, God has sent forth the Spirit of His Son into your hearts, crying, Abba, Father. Wherefore thou art no more a servant, but a son. And if a son, then an heir of God through Christ. Now, previously in the verses, he was saying, in history past, they were under tutors, as it were, and governors until the time was come that they could be adopted as sons. They were children, but they were not considered adopted sons. How do you become a child of God? You're born into His family. You must be born again. But adoption is a little bit further in understanding. Here's what would happen. The child would receive an inheritance as a child, but he was too young to really appreciate and be able to take care of that inheritance. So what they would do until a child reached a certain age, they would put that child under tutorship, under governorship, so that the governor and the tutor could instruct them, so when the time came, they would know how to use their inheritance properly, and so that they wouldn't misuse their inheritance as they were young. So they were treated just like a slave would be treated in the house, or a servant, not a slave in a sense of a tyrant type of slavery, but a servant in the house is how they were treated, even though they had the inheritance already given to them as a child. But when the age came, they were considered adopted as full heirs or sons, and no longer treated as the child that was under tutors and governors. When Jesus came into this world, that period of history where people were under the law, under its tutorship and governorship, was done away. And now all who receive Jesus Christ as Savior are already automatically adopted as sons with full privileges to their inheritance in Jesus Christ. Understand your position as a son of God. 1 John 3:1-2, and I was going to try to quote it, but I'm afraid I'll do it wrong, so I'm going to look it up real quick. Behold what manner of love the Father hath bestowed upon us, that we should be called the sons of God. Therefore the world knoweth us not, because it knew him not. Beloved, now are we the sons of God, and it doth not yet appear what we shall be, but we know that when he shall appear, we shall be like him, for we shall see him as he is. You not only are a child of God, but you have access to your inheritance in Jesus Christ. Use your privileges as a son of God. And one of those privileges is you can cry out to God the Father, Abba, Father. If you are saved, cry out to God in love, in adoration. Cry out to God for joy. Cry out to God for consolation, for strength, for courage, for wisdom, for opportunities, for support, for deliverance, for provision, for forgiveness, for cleansing, for victory, and for the pleasure of his presence. The Apostle Paul said, above all else, I want to know him. How well do you want to know your Father? If you are saved, make sure you are right with your Heavenly Father. You know, we understand that on an earthly term, because there are so many families that the children and the father have a strained relationship. Things aren't right between them. Still children, still father, but things aren't the way they could be and should be. Well, too often that's true with God and his children, isn't it? Yeah, I'm a child of God, but I'm not as close to him as I ought to be. I'm not as close to him as I could be. And listen, if that's a problem, it's not God's fault. He's willing, he's desiring for that intimate, close walk and relationship with you. If you are not as close to God as you feel you would like to be, it's your fault that you're not as close as you ought to be. You can ask God for cleansing and forgiveness, and you can ask God for help to get closer, drawn to him, draw near to God, and he will draw near to you. And strive by the Holy Spirit's enabling power to relate to him more closely and continually walk in fellowship with him. Can't do it in and of your own power. But if you're a child of God, you have the Holy Spirit to enable you. Make sure today that you are God's spiritual child through faith in Jesus Christ for salvation from sin and spiritual birth into God's family. John 1:12 says, but as many as received him, to them gave he the power to become the sons of God, even to them that believe on his name. I would encourage you today, if you have not yet repented of your sin and placed your faith in Jesus, that you do that before the day is over. If you would, even before you leave this place, call on Jesus in faith. If we can help you, we'd love to do that. You come to us and say, I need help with this. We'd love to direct you from the Word of God. Dear believer, are you as close to God as you really want to be? If you're not, how long will it take you to start taking measures to make things right? I would encourage you today, before the day is out, that you start making amends. If we confess our sin, He is faithful and just to forgive us our sins and to cleanse us from all unrighteousness. You might need to make some restitution. But do it today. And again, maybe you can even start the process before you leave this place. We're here to pray with you, to encourage you, to help you all we can. Let's take our hymnals, and before we sing this final song, let's close in a word of prayer. Father, I pray that you would speak to the hearts of each and every one of us and show us how we can have a closer relationship with you, where we can cry out with full confidence and boldness because we know we have this relationship with you. I pray that you would keep us from being satisfied with a halfway relationship, a relationship that's strained. May we, even if we have a close relationship, not be satisfied with where we are, but want a closer one. Draw us constantly to a closer walk with you, I pray. If there's a soul that needs to be saved today, I pray that you would show them their need, open their heart to the truth, and bring them to saving faith in Jesus Christ. I pray in Jesus' name. Amen. In closing, we're going to sing 611, Take My Life and Let It Be Consecrated, Lord, to Thee. Can't consecrate your life to the Lord until you know Jesus as Savior. That's where it all begins. Let's stand as we sing. You can come as we sing to indicate you would like somebody to help you out.